Matthew chapter 15, verses 1 through 20. The word of the Lord says this: Then some Pharisees and teachers of the law came to Jesus from Jerusalem and asked, "Why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? They don't wash their hands before they eat." Jesus replied, "And why do you break the command of God for the sake of your tradition? For God said, 'Honor your father and mother,' and anyone who curses his father or mother must be put to death. But you say that if a man says to his father or mother, 'Whatever help you might otherwise have received from me is a gift devoted to God,' he is not to honor his father and ought not to honor his father with it. Thus you nullify the word of God for the sake of your tradition. You hypocrites! Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men." Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Listen and understand. What goes into a man's mouth does not make him unclean, but what comes out of his mouth, that is what makes him unclean." Then the disciples came to him and asked, "Do you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this?" He replied, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be pulled up by the roots. Leave them. They are blind guides. If a blind man leads a blind man, both will fall into a pit." Peter said, "Explain the parable to us." "Are you still so dull?" Jesus asked them. "Don't you see that whatever enters the mouth goes into the stomach and then out of the body? But the things that come out of the mouth come from the heart, and these make a man unclean. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, slander. These are what make a man unclean. But eating with unwashed hands does not make him unclean." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we work through this account this morning, this account in the book of Matthew in your scriptures, enlighten us to the truth that is in it, your truth, your wisdom, the lesson that your son, Jesus Christ, taught to those around him as well. And may we be faithful to its interpretation and its application to our lives. Help us to meet with you now during this time. Open our hearts to hear from you and our bodies to do and to go afterwards. We ask these things in Christ's name. And people have already asked me, like, "Scott, why are you wearing a Phillies jersey this morning?" Because I'm a 49ers fan. That's why. It's very simple. At least I'm not the Browns, right? Yeah, we're not too far off. All right. We're getting into this scripture this morning, continuing our sermon series on discipleship. We're talking out of the book of Matthew, chapter 15, verses 1 through 20. And I did something last week that I don't normally do. I failed in my job as part of my job, and I had this conversation with George earlier this week when we were together. I said, you know, I have my sermon series laid out usually months in advance. I don't have the specific message, but I like to have the series laid out, you know, and scripture references months in advance. And when I prepared my message last week, I didn't do my due diligence and look at the scripture that I was going to be preaching out of this week. And so some of my message last week, if you'll remember correctly, which I'm sure you all do because you hang on every word that is spoken in here on Sunday mornings, was taken out of this passage. So I'm kind of double dipping from Matthew chapter 15 this week. So forgive me for that, but it is what it is. There's still a lot that we can glean out of this passage and a lot that we can take away from it. Before we do that, I want to play a quick little game. It's called Can You Imagine? Can you imagine? And some of these scenarios of can you imagine can be reversed. Some of them cannot. So, for example, can you imagine being a vegetarian in a hunting family? That scenario can be reversed. Can you imagine being a meat eater in a family of vegetarians? Can you imagine being the lone Dallas Cowboys fan at an Eagles-Cowboys game at Lincoln Financial Field? I can't reverse that one because Philly is what Philly is, right? You know, you can be an Eagles fan at a Cowboys game, but you probably wouldn't fear for your life near as much, right? Can you imagine being a Christian in an all-Muslim family, or can you imagine being a Muslim in an all-Christian family? I mean, these scenarios are kind of difficult, aren't they? And they're scenarios that are uncomfortable to think about. They're uncomfortable to contemplate or go there. But I'm bringing these scenarios up for a reason, because there's something going on in this passage that you got to look at from Christ's point of view and go, can you imagine? You see, as we start in verse 1 this morning, it says, then some Pharisees and teachers of the law came to Jesus from Jerusalem. I don't know if you picked up on that. It's one of those verses that's kind of the start. It's easy to gloss over. It's easy to look at and be like, well, it's kind of irrelevant. But it's not irrelevant. It's very relevant. Some Pharisees and teachers of the law came to Jesus. Jesus did not go to them. They came to him. They came to him from Jerusalem, but Jesus himself was not in Jerusalem at this point. So where was Jesus? Well, if we back up in Scripture a little bit, we can figure it out. Chapter 14 of the book of Matthew, verse 34, the word says this. When they had crossed over, they landed in Gennesaret. Gennesaret. Now, where exactly is this? We're not exactly sure, modern day, exactly where it was. But it's believed to be on the west side of the Sea of Galilee, a fertile land, which puts it approximately 65 miles from Jerusalem. It is of note, and you should understand at this point in time, that the Pharisees and teachers of law did not have automatic transportation. They could not just hop in their vehicles, drive down to Galilee for the day, and talk to Jesus. Approximately a 65-mile journey on foot was a couple days' trip. So why did these Pharisees and teachers of the law go and visit Jesus at Gennesaret? According to Matthew chapter 14, if we read a little further, the answer comes to us in verses 35 and 36. When the men of that place recognized Jesus, they sent word to all the surrounding country. And what happened? People brought in all their sick to him and begged him to let the sick just touch the edge of his cloak, and all who touched him were healed. So why did they come? They came because Jesus was doing the Jesus thing. Jesus was meeting with people. He was talking to people. He was touching people at their point of need. They were being healed by literally simply touching his cloak. And this is attracting a crowd. How do we know that? In verse 35, when the men of that place recognized Jesus, they sent word to all the surrounding country. People were coming in droves to see Christ. And it's easy to see that this was viewed as a threatening gesture to the established religious community. If they were willing to send the Pharisees and these teachers of the law 65 miles to confront Christ, they were obviously agitated by it, right? It was obviously more than just something at face value. So they show up, they attempt to discredit and disprove Jesus by asking a question that was regarding the Jewish law and the handling of that law by Jesus' disciples. Now, we understand what? What was their question? He said, why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? They don't wash their hands before they eat. This was a law of tradition. This was not a law of scriptures. Let me say it again. This was a law of tradition. This was not a law of scriptures. And what do you mean by that? Well, the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8, verse 10, says these words. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. And you're thinking to yourself, Scott, why do you bring up Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 10? Well, this is the only verse in the Old Testament scriptures that references a blessing associated with a meal, with the partaking of a meal. Okay? God has provided. We offer up a blessing. That's it. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 10. And you're thinking to yourself, Scott, again, why bring up that verse? Because that verse I just read you, let me read it again if you didn't pick up on it. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. That verse was the genesis, was the beginning of this rule about hand washing. But Scott, what does it have to do about hand washing? The answer, jack squat. I don't know if you picked up on that. It doesn't have anything to do about hand washing, but that's where it started. You see, the religious teachers and the religious people took that verse to be praising God for your meals and for your provision to say that other things needed to be done, including this hand washing thing, which means it's a law of tradition, not a law of scriptures. And I just realized I'm wearing sneakers up here today. I feel much lighter on my feet. Like, this is really great. I'm hopping around. This is weird. Okay. Mark says it a little different. Mark has the exact same account, Mark chapter 7, but in verses 3 and 4 of the book of Mark, it says this. The Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they give their hands a ceremonial washing, holding to the tradition of the elders. When they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash, and they observe many other traditions, such as the washing of cups, pitchers, and kettles. Other than that part there, the account in Mark is almost identical word for word to the account in Matthew. But it helps to give some insight about this tradition, this rule of hand washing. I bring that up because we need to ask the question, can you imagine? Remember we played the Can You Imagine game earlier? Can you imagine the frustration that Christ must have experienced at this encounter? Are you kidding me? You're taking Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 10, and trying to pin something on me about my disciples not washing their hands because of that? Can you imagine the righteous indignation that he must have been experiencing at this point? I think we can all agree and sympathize to an extent with Christ. But we should also be forced into introspection at this point. We should be forced to ask the question, do we do the same thing today? Have we taken tradition and made it part of our religion? And I know what you're all thinking. No, we haven't. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you some modern day examples of how the church in America may follow the traditions of man and not necessarily the Word of God. This might get uncomfortable. You might not agree with me. And you know what? That's okay. Because what I really want you to do through this part of the message is think about what I'm saying. Not think about if I'm right or wrong. Well, maybe that's a good part of it. But get into the Bible and see if I'm right or wrong. Right? Some of them are stupid. Some of them are serious. The fact that we're all sitting in here on a Sunday is the fact that we've taken the tradition of man over the Word of God, right? Because it's Sunday. Newsflash, the Sabbath is Saturday. So if we were taking the Word of God at face value, we'd be meeting here yesterday morning, not this morning. Sabbath on a Sunday was introduced by the Council of Nicaea about 300 years after the death of Christ. How about the fact that we sing during worship time together? It's not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing at all. In fact, it's a wonderful thing. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19, the word Lord says, speak to one another with hymns, psalms, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord. Wouldn't you love it if I spoke to you from the front through hymns, psalms, and spiritual songs? I'd be a YouTube sensation in no time, man. How about Psalms chapter 150 says, praise God in his sanctuary. It goes on to say all sorts of stuff. I think I booked it. Yeah, Psalm 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and the lyre. Praise him with the tambourine and dancing. Praise him with strings and flute. Praise him with clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. And isn't that what so many of you desire on a Sunday morning? More resounding and clashing of cymbals in your lives? Matt, please play those drums louder is what you're all thinking. And he's just sitting back there with a big old smile on his face right now. I've been waiting for you to bring up that passage, Pastor Scott, for years. It's not bad to sing. It's not bad to play music. It's just not biblical that every Sunday morning when we get together, we have to do worship. So if I said some Sunday morning you showed up and I'm like, just so you guys know, we're not having a really singing time ever again in this body. We're just going to get together and we're going to pray and you're going to listen to me. You'd be like, that's wrong. And you're right, it would be, but it's certainly not unbiblical. Do you know that nobody really knows for sure exactly the day when Christ was born? And it more than likely wasn't even close to December 25th. In fact, most of the holidays that we celebrate, most of the traditions that we celebrate around Christmas are based in pagan traditions. For example, the festival of Saturnalia, a worship time to the Roman god of Saturn, was originally over the time that we celebrate Christmas. The winter solstice was another reason that it was chosen around December 25th, because it's approximately a week after the longest day of the year. The Jewish Hanukkah holiday falls over the same time. So it just made sense that we celebrate Christmas around the same time. But we really don't know exactly what day Christ was born. Now, and please understand that as we go from here, some of you, like I said, may disagree with me and may disagree with me for a reason, but understand that in everything I bring up here, There will be one incredibly smart biblical scholar that will tell you one thing, and another incredibly smart biblical scholar that will tell you the exact opposite. How about infant baptism? We don't do infant baptism at our church, but many churches believe in infant baptism. What's the word of the Lord say? It says, repent and be baptized, right? It's kind of hard to repent when you're an infant. How about our Easter schedule? This is a good one, right? Get online if you have time, right? Look up and see what day of the week Christ was crucified on. It's going to be Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday. And you are going to find equal arguments for each day and why it is that day. And everybody will be very sure of themselves. But do we really know for sure? How about let's get a little bit more specific about some of our traditions, some of our beliefs. These might hit a little bit closer to home. Do you understand that the idea of a sinner's prayer is never founded anywhere in the scriptures? That's sinner's prayer, right? The way most of us came into a saving faith was at a church service or a service of some sort, and we were called to the front, and we knelt before the altar, and we prayed the sinner's prayer. Pray these words after me. Nowhere in the Bible do you ever find anywhere that says that you have to pray a prayer to be saved. Nowhere. Acts chapter 16, verse 31 says, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you'll be saved. Acts 17, 30 says what? He now commands all people everywhere to repent as a process of your salvation. Nowhere does it say ever that you must pray and be saved. Should you pray? Should you communicate with God? Absolutely. Is it how you get saved? No. But most of us, if you ask us about our salvation, will take us back to a time when we did what? Prayed the prayer. It's not biblical. One author put it this way. He says, again, though it is crucially important for you, it is crucially important that you do not base your salvation on having said a prayer. Reciting a prayer cannot save you. If you want to receive the salvation that is available through Jesus, place your faith in him. Fully trust his death as the sufficient sacrifice for your sins. Completely rely on him alone as your Savior. That is the biblical method of salvation. If you have received Jesus as your Savior, by all means, say a prayer to God. Tell God how thankful you are for Jesus. Offer praise to God for his love and sacrifice. Thank Jesus for dying for your sins and providing salvation for you. That is the biblical connection between salvation and prayer. You know, last week we celebrated communion together. And I love being a brother in Christ and growing up in the Brother in Christ Church. I love how we many times and oftentimes eat unleavened bread as a way of remembering the body of Christ. And growing up in this tradition, I like it. And I was talking to somebody, or I heard of a conversation last week of somebody who has not grown up in that tradition, and it was the first time they had partaken of unleavened bread. And we're kind of like, probably like a lot like, you know, the Israelites when manna fell from heaven, what is this? And why am I putting it in my mouth, right? And that's great. We do that. Now, if we were to take the Bible at face value, we would eat unleavened bread, and what would we drink? Grape juice? Wine! And some of you are going, yes! Right? But we don't, for obvious reasons. But isn't it interesting? How about the practice, the communion practice of eating or drinking in an unworthy manner? 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 27 through 29. Let me read it for you once I find it, because I did not mark it. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 27 through 29. The word of the Lord says this, therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. Did you all think about that before you took communion last week? You know, one of the ones we've talked about in Sunday school and touched on a couple times is the inerrancy of the Bible. Is the Bible inerrant? Psalm chapter 119, 160 says, all your words are true. All your righteous laws are eternal. 2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17, all scriptures God-breathed is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. 2 Peter 1, 21, for prophecy never had its origin in man, in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Lots of words, lots of examples of inspiration and authority and anointing by the Spirit, but no specific references to inerrant or infallible. And this is one where you will have Bible scholars fall on both sides. You'll have Bible scholars fall on both sides of the debate. How about another one of my favorites? Revival meetings. And I'm not bashing revival meetings per se. I think many in here, or some of us, have probably come to faith through revival meetings of some sort. But what gets me about this whole concept is that we're going to schedule a specific time for the Holy Spirit to show up. And I've told you about the Babylon Bee before, this Christian satire website that I like to read from. They hit the nail on the head on this one, I think. They wrote this article. They say, a carefully planned, spontaneous outbreak of God's Spirit onto his people, originally slated for this Friday, has been postponed. As church leader at a local Assemblies of God congregation discovered a conflict with a previously arranged night of healing to take place at that same location, sources confirmed. We apologize for the mix-up on when the Holy Spirit was scheduled to move powerfully among us, church leaders wrote in a statement Monday. We had forgotten that we had already arranged for a night of healing to take place in the fellowship hall, so we had to cancel the Spirit-led time of incredible revival. Depending on a scheduling issue with an instructional class on speaking in tongues, the church will reportedly be tentatively rescheduling the powerful time of unbelievable, unplanned spiritual revival for the middle of November. Revival meetings have been historically beneficial and productive and a way of the Holy Spirit moving. Many have come to faith. John chapter 15, verse 5 says, I am the vine, you are the branches. If man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. You see, we need to rely and depend on the Holy Spirit in every aspect of our lives. Every breath that we take, every action that we do, everything we are should be inspired by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not like the genie from Aladdin. The Holy Spirit isn't this thing that you rub out of a lamp to get what you want when you want it. Because at that point, it's about you, and it's never about you. If you're walking in faith with Christ, it's always about Christ. It's not about you. It's about the will of the Holy Spirit. What's interesting is the book of Matthew, chapter 18, verse 20 says what? Where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am also. I have to wonder if our revival meetings aren't successful because of that, not so much because of the scheduling of the Holy Spirit. Because people are meeting together and praying and experiencing God. And maybe you're thinking to yourself right now, man, Scott, you are way off topic. I'm not even sure where you're going with this message. And there might be some truth to that. But I want you to realize that maybe, just possibly, we are guilty of the same things that the Pharisees and the teachers of the law are guilty of in this passage today. Maybe we've become a little too dependent upon our traditions and routines, and maybe we need a little bit more of Jesus in our lives. You see, this entire passage is based upon the tendency of these people who call themselves religious to gravitate to the easy and comfortable. Let me say it again. They're gravitating towards what's easy and comfortable, and these are the religious elite. The traditions and routines that were in place, just like today, are easy and comfortable because the familiarity with those traditions leads us to believe that that's what gets us closer to God. That's what puts us closer to God. And there's a newsflash for you. God is already close to you. You don't have to do the right thing. You don't have to say the right thing. You don't have to dress the right way. Obviously, look at us today, right? You don't have to perform their duty properly. Psalm 145, verse 18 says, The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. You see, what's interesting about this passage is that it was the disciples, the close followers of Christ. These were the guys that were accused of breaking the traditions of the religious. Verse 2 says what? Why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? They don't wash their hands before they eat. As disciples of Christ, you are called to follow Christ, not tradition. Where Christ leads, you follow. You don't go where tradition tells you to go unless Christ is leading you in that direction. And what happened in this particular passage, verses 3 through 9, was that Jesus was calling out the Pharisees. I don't know if you picked up on that. It's kind of hidden in there in verses 3, 4, and 5. Let's read it real quick. And why do you break, this is Jesus' response, why do you break the command of God for the sake of your tradition? For God said, honor your father and mother, and anyone who curses his father or mother must be put to death. But you say that if a man, says to his father or mother, whatever help you might otherwise have received from me is a gift devoted to God, he is not to honor his father with it. See, there's something going on here. Something in Jewish tradition that's called a korbans. Korban, that's how we would interpret it today. And this korban is almost like a promise. Like when churches do a building fund, right? People pledge to give a certain amount to the building fund. And what's happening, and what's happened is people have pledged to give money to the church. The problem is they have pledged to give money to the church, this korban, while neglecting their family, while neglecting their parents, the elderly in their community. People are going hungry. People aren't having places to live and shelter to live in. They're not providing for it. And you know what the Pharisees and the religious leader are doing? They're going, yeah, you guys are doing the right thing. Keep giving to the church. And Jesus is going, no, you're not doing the right thing. You're not giving to the church. You need to be giving to the needy among you. You need to be caring for those who are with you, who are those who are in your communities, those who I've entrusted you. These are the people you need to be looking out for. You don't need to keep fattening the wallet of these guys. That's what's happening in verses 3, 4, and 5, and into 6 there. Then we get, and Jesus had some harsh words there too, didn't he? Verses 8, 9. 7, 8, 9. You hypocrites. You hypocrites! Isaiah was right when he said this about you. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men. And then he turns to the crowd. He turns away from the religious leaders, puts his back to them, turns to the crowd, and verses 10 and 11 says what? Listen and understand. What goes into a mouth, man's mouth does not make him unclean, but what comes out of his mouth, that is what makes him unclean. And we get to this interesting exchange that I mentioned last week in verse 12. The disciples came to him, they came to Jesus, and asked, did you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this? Really? You're worried about what the Pharisees hear? You're worried about their feelings? You're worried about them being offended? I'm pretty sure Jesus knew he was offending the Pharisees when he called them hypocrites, right? That's not a term of endearment if you haven't figured that out. Then he goes on in verse 13 and 14. Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be pulled up by the roots. Leave them. They are blind guides. If a blind man leads a blind man, both will fall into a pit. Who and what are you following in your life? Are you following Christ or are you following Pastor Scott? You better not be following me. I mean that from the bottom of my heart. You see, the fact that even the disciples didn't get it right here should alarm us all to a tiny bit, to a little bit of an extent. It should cause us to ask ourselves who and what we are following. Do you take what Scott says on Sunday morning at face value, or do you actually get in and look? And I know I challenge you that on a constant basis. I know I say it once a month or once every other month, but I truly mean it. It's not enough to sit here and listen to what I'm saying without looking into it to see if what I'm interpreting is correct. It's not enough to not talk about it with other people in this church body or friends at work or other Christians. Because what if I'm wrong? And I know I'm never wrong. But guess what? You know the answer to that. Are we filling ourselves with our own tendencies and our own desires and our own version of the truth? You see, if you are a disciple of Christ, your pursuit should be of Christ, not of any man or any man-made tradition. And then we get to verses 15 through 20. Peter finally says, look, Jesus, explain the parable to us. This is the thing that wraps it all together. Jesus says, are you still so dull? Don't you see that whatever enters the mouth goes into the stomach and then out of the body? But the things that come out of the mouth come from the heart, and these make a man unclean. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, slander. These are what make a man unclean. But eating with unwashed hands does not make him unclean. And what Jesus is stating in this passage is a pretty big deal. Don't you see that whatever enters the mouth and goes into the stomach and then out of the body? It's verse 17. Jesus saying, what you eat is not going to be counted against you. It is not a big deal. But please understand, it was a very big deal to the people who were hearing him say these words at the time. A large part of the first 11 chapters of the book of Leviticus, and especially chapter 11 in the book of Leviticus, deals with foods that are and are not appropriate for consumption. And much of what they ate was filtered through that. Everything that they ate was filtered through it. So for you and I, we sit here today, and let's be honest, most of us are going to have some pork at some point today, right? Most of us are going to have some cow at some point today. Most of us are going to have all sorts of stuff, whether it's good or not for our body. Most of us are going to eat stuff that would have been definitely on the ban list for these people, and we're not going to bat an eyelash about it. But they did, and they should have, with the way the law was interpreted at that time. God was very specific about what his followers were and were not to eat. And the Pharisees were much like us today. They were very good at delineating between the black and white. So it was specific. You can eat this. You can. They had it down to every animal, every piece of food, every piece of meat. You can and you cannot eat this. But we all know that the reality of situations differently, don't we? That reality of our lives is not black and white very often. The reality of our lives is often gray. Let me give you an example. When I was in youth group, I wanted to know the answer to the question that everybody in my youth group, and probably everybody in every other youth group, whether they're ready to admit it or willing to admit it or not, wanted to know. As a teenager, what did we want to know? How far was too far to go before you're married? That's what all good Christian teenagers want to know. Sexually, how far is too far to go before you're married? And if you grew up in the church, you're smiling and laughing, and if you're not on the outside, you are on the inside, because you wanted to know the same answer to that question. Whether you had the guts to ask it or not is a different story. But the answer, there is no answer to that question, is there? Like, we wanted to know a specific, what if I hold hands? Is that sinning? Am I not okay with that, right? What if I kiss a girl? Is that sinning? I don't know. Right? We wanted to know the specifics, and the Pharisees would have been glad to make something up. They would have been glad to tell us. But the real answer to the question is what? The real answer to the question is, when your heart begins to lust for something other than God, it becomes an infatuation and a sin. And that is different for every person, right? But how do you explain that to a group of teenagers with raging hormones? I don't know and have not been effectively able to do it. So if you come with an answer, let me know. But that's the answer. It's all about where your heart lies. And so the Pharisees come across with this idea, this desire to quantify the heart. They want to put rules and regulations on heart stuff in every aspect of their faith. Why? So that they could prove their faith to God through their own efforts. But that doesn't work out so good for any of us, does it? If you can earn your way to God, then you really don't need God, do you? Although the Pharisees claimed to be God and his representatives, they didn't need God. You see, their rules revolved around their obedience to the rules, not their obedience to God. What do your rules revolve around? What do the rules of this church revolve around? And Jesus addresses the heart in verses 18 through 20. Exactly what makes a person unclean. Evil thoughts that come from the heart. Murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, and slander. This is the stuff that Jesus is concerned with. Why? Because it's a heart issue. We make our kids wash our hands. Wash their hands. We don't make them wash our hands. We make our kids wash their hands before they eat. Much to their chagrin often. Especially with the boy. I mean, you'd think we're asking him to go cut his foot off or something at times. And I'm sure many of you experience the same thing. If my kids don't wash their hands, does that make them sinful? Does that set me off on some tangent as a parent where they are completely unrespecting of God's word in their lives? Of course not, because it's not a heart issue, it's a laziness issue. That's basically what it comes down to, and it was for me when I was their age too. It does sometimes now at my age. It's not a heart issue. Washing hands is not a heart issue. Evil thoughts are a heart issue. Sexual immorality is a heart issue. Slander is a heart issue. Theft is a heart issue. All this stuff is a heart issue, and that's what Christ is concerned with. And you know what? I don't know if you realize this or not, but in this passage, who is Jesus specifically talking to in verses 18 through 20? He's not talking to the crowds anymore. He's not talking to the Pharisees and teachers of law. He's talking with his disciples. As a disciple of Christ, what do you think Jesus is most concerned with? How is the condition of your heart? What is coming out of your heart? What are churches most concerned with? Pews versus chairs? Hymns versus worship songs? Formal dress versus casual dress? I say these because these are things that have literally split churches apart. Literally split churches apart. How do we dress on Sunday mornings? What kind of chairs or seating do we sit in? What kind of music should we sing? Literally splits churches apart. And it's all traditions of men. All of it. Is this what burdens your heart? Or is it people at your workplace who don't know Christ that burden your heart? How about the heroin epidemic that is running rampant through our society, tearing apart families and taking lives way too early? Is that what burdens your heart? How about the fact that today is Super Bowl Sunday and is widely, widely regarded as the largest human trafficking event of the year in the host city of the Super Bowl by victim advocate groups? Approximately 10,000 prostitutes will be brought to Houston over this weekend alone. Most of them underage. Most of them against their will. You see, a heart of a disciple breaks for the things that Christ's heart breaks for, not the traditions instituted by men. In Luke chapter 19, verses 41 through 44, the scripture records what? As Jesus approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it. Why did Jesus weep over Jerusalem? This is before the Passover feast. This was before the crucifixion, before the torture. He wept over Jerusalem because he knew it was about to happen. He knew that the same people saying, "Hosanna, glory to God in the highest," and waving the palm branches as he entered that city today, would a couple days later be the exact same people saying what? "Crucify him. Crucify him." He knew when he went into that city that approximately 40 years later, that city would be leveled by war and destruction and things would not be the same again. He knew that his time of ministry was almost over. And as sweet as it was with some of the people, he had healed, he had saved, he had cleansed many. According to John chapter 1, verse 11, the majority still rejected him. And so it broke his heart. What breaks the heart of Christ? Unbelief and rejection. That's what he was experiencing in this passage when he wept in Luke chapter 19, verse 41. What breaks your heart? I'm going to close with a real quick story that I saw on, I think it was actually on Facebook this week. I saw a video, and I did not like it. I simply didn't like it because I don't like the Patriots. I don't want any reason to cheer for the Patriots. I want every reason to despise them. I'm just like you. We don't like the Patriots, vast majority of us. Vast majority of us don't like the Cowboys either. I'm sorry, Mark, but that's okay. Like, they're the two, we don't like the Yankees, you know? Everybody likes Philadelphia because they're horrible at everything, right? Well, maybe not everybody. But I saw a video of a guy on the Patriots team. His name is Matthew Slater. His dad was an all-pro offensive tackle for the Los Angeles Rams back in the 70s and 80s. One of the best players to ever play the game. His son, Matthew Slater, is a special teams specialist with the New England Patriots. You know what he was doing this week at the Super Bowl when they were interviewing him about the game and stuff like that? He was sitting at his podium, and he was testifying about Christ. He was testifying about why he believes in Christ. He was testifying about what it means to him to be a believer, what the plan of salvation entails for him. And that's how he's known on his team, and that's how he's known around the league. And the reason I hated the video is because I loved what he was saying. And I don't want to cheer for the Patriots, but I will be cheering for Matthew Slater, because I believe that his heart beats in tune with Christ's heart as well. It would have been very easy for him to sit back and answer with nothing but football questions, keep Christ to himself. It would have been much more comfortable, and people wouldn't be putting him out as much. But he chose to be obedient as a disciple of Christ to the calling and the leading of Christ on his life. And I think that should be a challenge to us as well. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as your disciples, challenge us to follow wherever you lead. I pray that the things that would break your heart are the same things that would break our heart. Help us to have the wisdom and the knowledge to look past the trivial and into the concerning things in our world. Give us a heart for those who don't know you, whether it's somebody in the workplace or somebody down the street or somebody literally halfway across the world. Help us to follow our leadings and our passions and our lives that are given to us by you for the furthering of your kingdom, not for our glory, but for your glory, not for our honor, but for your honor. Help us to walk humbly in step with you. Challenge us to get out of our comfort zone, to break the traditions that are coming from us and not from you, so that we can focus on you with our whole hearts. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.